The idea for the Hyperloop came about when Elon Musk realized that Silicon Valley, which is the hub of technological development in the world, did not have an effective intercity transport system. California does have a high-speed rail system, but in Elon Musk's words, it's one of the slowest and most expensive rail systems in the world. The lack of efficient intercity transport compelled Musk to think about a new mode of travel that could be fast, safe, relatively cheap, and not disruptive for other commuters. Musk calls it the fifth mode of travel. For inter- and intra-city travel ranging between 900 to 1,500 kilometers, a supersonic jet would not be feasible. It would be more efficient to take a jet for a journey greater than 1,500 kilometers, but anything less than that just wouldn't make sense. A jet would lose precious time ascending and descending, not to mention the duration of the flight itself for such a short distance would not be enough to maintain cruising altitude. Using a high-speed bullet train system can also be ruled out because California already tried it. The result was that it was simply not effective enough. There's also the added danger of accidents with high-speed rails. The higher the speed, the more risk factors add up, which make it unfeasible to achieve super or hypersonic speeds. The Alpha X, which is a high-speed bullet train being developed by Japan, is expected to top 360 kilometers per hour, while the conceptual Hyperloop is expected to top 1,080 kilometers per hour. This is why Musk has ruled out trains, because they simply can't reach the speed that he has in mind for the Hyperloop. And this, by default, rules out cars and bikes. So with all four modes of transport ruled out, how did Musk envision his Hyperloop to be? Well, sit back and relax because we're about to find out. But before we start, make sure you smash that like button and subscribe to the channel for more awesome tech videos like this. What is the Hyperloop? In his own words, Musk considers the Hyperloop as a cross between a Concorde, a railgun, and an air hockey table, with the following characteristics: safer, faster, lower cost, more convenient, immune to bad weather, sustainably self-powering, and resistant to earthquakes. Musk pulled together a hybrid team from SpaceX and Tesla to work on the initial concept that came to be known as Hyperloop Alpha. In the initial concept, Musk goes over the possible design features while acknowledging that a lot of things will need to be reconsidered once the Hyperloop goes from conceptual to experimental and then the final design stages. For now, the Hyperloop is effectively in its conceptual and experimental stages. The key to any high-speed travel is overcoming friction. The fastest travel can be achieved in space where there's no friction. On Earth, however, friction cannot be eliminated because of air, which is why the Hyperloop has a big tube to create a closed space which can allow the creation of some sort of vacuum. Elon Musk knew early on that creating a vacuum in a long tube and using person-sized pods to transport people from one point to another would achieve the required speed, but it would simply not be possible to maintain vacuum in a long tube with several hundred or thousands of people entering and exiting the pod every moment. Even a tiny puncture in the tube would make the whole system useless. So a completely vacuum-based, frictionless tube having pods powered by electromagnetics wasn't going to work. Musk believed that creating a tube with a very low pressure, maintained by commercial pumps, could be the way to create a Hyperloop, but there was still the Kantrowitz limit to consider. The Kantrowitz limit refers to the speed at which a pod can travel in a narrow tube. Basically, when you have a very narrow tube and you push a pod through it, you have to do it either extremely fast to overcome air resistance, or do it extremely slow so that the pod cuts through the air very slowly. If not done right, the pod in the tube would act like a syringe, pushing the whole column of air with the pod along the length of the tube, which would render the Hyperloop useless. Musk worked his way around the problem by suggesting the addition of a small compressor at the front of the pod. The compressor would simply divert the airflow from the front of the pod to its back, creating an air cushion in the process. This ingenious addition of an air compressor not only deals with the Kantrowitz limit, but also solves the problem of suspension. The compressor diverts the airflow around the pod, creating an air cushion, thus eliminating the need for a separate suspension system for the pod. The pods are to be powered mainly through solar panels situated over the tube. The initial power to push the pod with high velocity is going to come from the solar panels and an independently built propulsion system, which is not yet finalized. The tube is going to have accelerators or speed boosters along the whole route to maintain the speed of the pod for when it's going both up or downhill. The pod itself would be powered by lithium-ion batteries, which are the same batteries that are used to power Tesla cars. The pod would also need power for the air compressor and the passenger compartment, which is expected to have all the comforts that can possibly be installed into a hyperspeed pod, such as lighting and entertainment systems. Though I doubt anyone traveling at hyperspeed would have the attention span to watch something on a TV screen, imagine going around a curve in the Hyperloop, experiencing 3G G-force, while simultaneously binge-watching your latest Netflix show. Anyway, the design of the pods can also have transparent viewing screens that the passengers can watch the scenery as they zip through time and space. Once again, it sounds good on paper, but at subsonic speeds, pretty much everything outside the pod would look like a blur. In that case, it may be a good idea to keep the pod entertainment systems online. Maybe a VR headset could be used to fully immerse the passenger. Who knows? Each one of these pods can carry up to 2 people, and apart from the passenger pods, there are also cargo pods being considered. The route of the Hyperloop is expected to closely follow the major highways, but the Hyperloop, for obvious reasons, can't take any sharp turns. It can, at most, take very obtuse curves. According to Elon Musk, the best way to build the Hyperloop is over ground on a separate bridge that runs parallel to the highway. This would eliminate the need for buying land. In places where the pylons may need to be placed on public or private property, they can be done so with minimal encroachment. Building an underground Hyperloop would not only require the purchase of land, but also excessive digging and tunneling costs, which would render the whole concept useless as it would no longer remain feasible. The initial Hyperloop Alpha concept given by Elon Musk is expected to cost around $6 billion. However, the accuracy of this figure can't truly be identified because the Hyperloop is still in its conceptual phase. According to Musk, the bulk of the expenditure is going to be incurred on the Hyperloop tube and infrastructure, whereas the pods and the technology required to create and run them is going to be minimal. The term minimal here refers to at least a few $100 million. So in any case, even the Los Angeles section of the Hyperloop is going to be a multi-billion dollar project at least. Now, from the very beginning, SpaceX has made the development of the Hyperloop an open-sourced project. In 2015, SpaceX announced the Hyperloop Pod Competition, where students and professionals were invited to compete against each other in the best and most functional Hyperloop pod design. The Technical University of Munich has won each Hyperloop design competition that's been held since 2016. Each year, they beat their own speed record. The last competition was held in 2019, where a team from the Technical University of Munich achieved a speed of 463 kilometers per hour in a 1-mile-long test track built by SpaceX. It's very important to note that the Hyperloop project is a completely open-source project, and SpaceX itself doesn't claim to have the sole rights for it, which can be seen by the fact that once Elon Musk announced his idea for the Hyperloop in 2012, multiple firms were set up by different individuals to work on the concept. Hyperloop Transportation Technologies, HTT, is the first company that was founded in 2013 to work on the concept. HTT conducted initial testing and feasibility on an 8-kilometer test track in Los Angeles. In December 2016, HTT entered into a contract with the government of Abu Dhabi to build a test track between Abu Dhabi and Al Ain, which would reduce the travel time between the two cities to under 10 minutes. It must be mentioned at this point that it's been almost 5 years since this contract was signed, and the test track has not yet been built. HTT similarly entered into an agreement with the Indian government in 2017 to build a test track, but this track is still only on paper. HTT has also got contracts with the government of Ukraine and China to build similar tracks. All the contracts of HTT are in their conceptual state as of now, so only time will tell if they'll get any real traction. Virgin Hyperloop is another company that's working on the same concept. It was formed in 2014 and is thus far the only company to have tested a fully functional Hyperloop. Virgin tested their fully functional Hyperloop system in 2017 after which they got into a contract with the government of India to build a Hyperloop between Mumbai and Pune to reduce a 3-hour train journey to just 25 minutes. Virgin Hyperloop carried out a successful dummy test of their Hyperloop between Mumbai and Pune in November 2020. After reaching up to 700 kilometers per hour, the successful test encouraged the Indian government to approach Virgin Hyperloop to carry out feasibility tests for more Hyperloops located within India. The reason why India is so interested in Hyperloop systems is because every day, millions of people commute from one city to another for work. At present, the bulk of this commute happens through the absolutely massive railway system of India. The government is now looking for innovative ways that can reduce traveling time and speed up the commute to take the load off the railway systems. So, if there's any country where you can expect to see the first public Hyperloop system, it's gotta be India. The Hyperloop Alpha project in Los Angeles is certainly on the cards for SpaceX, and Elon Musk has stated that he will himself overlook the project. But for now, the biggest obstacle for this project is funding and approval by the state. There are environmental, cost, and safety concerns that need to be addressed first. SpaceX can make some headway with the government if it manages to successfully build and run its pilot Hyperloop system over the 1-kilometer test track. Once the company has got a working model of the Hyperloop, it'll be easier to convince the state government to consider funding the project. So far, Hyperloop projects in various parts of the world are in various conceptual and experimentation phases. They're being delayed by technology and funding, which means that at some point in the near future, we can expect a fully functional public Hyperloop system. Keep an eye on both India and the USA for a functional Hyperloop system because these two countries are showing the greatest interest right now. Once the first public Hyperloop system is successfully unveiled, we can expect the Hyperloop to become a mainstream mode of transport, with every country rushing after the company that manages to build it first. In a funny way, the Hyperloop can be compared to the early test flights by the Wright brothers. It took a lot of testing and development before airplanes saw any light. Most people at the time thought they'd never work. Yet today, millions of people from around the world travel both domestically and internationally using airplanes. So watch out for the Hyperloop in the next few decades, because there's a good chance it will soon be one of the most popular forms of travel. As always, if you enjoyed today's video and you want to see more, make sure you hit that subscribe button to stay updated on all our latest releases. Other than that, thanks for tuning in, and I'll see you in the next video.